do expect it to hit $10,000 an ounce in the coming years. We're not suddenly going to just bounce back and everything's going to be the same. That's not true. If Bitcoin is not money, then it's like playing roulette. And that life behavior is quite different than it was before. And these
네, 세계의 석학들과 구루들을 찾아서 그들의 지혜와 인사이트와 또 그들의 해석과 분석들을 들어보는 세상 유익한 시간 3프로TV와 중앙일보가 함께하는 3프로TV의 이프로와 중앙일보의 대표기자 강남규 기자가 함께하는 글로벌 머니톡 시간입니다.
졸지에 대표기자가 됐습니까?
아유, 네, 감사합니다. 소개하기 전에 나오시면 안 되겠습니다. 네, 강남규 기자를 소개하겠습니다.
예, 강남규입니다.
네. 방송 오늘 어려워요. 네,
아, 오래, 예. 아, 이 기사 쓰는 것보단 확실히 어려운 것 같아요. 멀티태스킹을 네. 해야 되니까. 여러 가지 변수를 감안해야 된다는 의미죠.
네. 처음에 우리가 이거 시작할 때는 네. 그냥 친한 외국인 한 서너 명 그냥 하고 말 거지, 너희들. 이라고 의심의 눈으로 바라보는 분들도 꽤 있었습니다만.
예.
저희가 이 정도입니다.
그렇죠.
또 준비했습니다. 예. 오늘은 제임스 리카즈라는 분을 인터뷰할 예정인데요. 이분이 최근에 낸 저서를 우리나라에서도 출판을 했네요.
예. 그 신대공황. 공황이 아니고 공황입니다.
공황.
신대공황.
네.
사실 그 제임스 리카즈 앞에 이렇게 여러분들께서 위키피디아를 조회를 해보시면은 아주 잡다한 수식어가 붙습니다. 일단 이 사람이 법률가예요. 변호사이고요.
네.
그 다음에 두 번째는 경제학을 훈련을 배웠고 그래서 이코노미스트로도 분류가 됩니다. 또 이 사람이 과거에 한때 투자은행가로서 활동을 했습니다.
돈도, 지금 돈도 벌고 법도 잘 알며 경제학을 공부한.
예. 그 다음에 이제 최근에 와가지고는 뭐 방송 코멘테이터, 그 다음에 각종 컨퍼런스에서 유명한 그 연설자, 네. 발표자.
한마디로
스피커.
한마디로 잘났군요.
예. 제가 이 적어 왔습니다. 우리 예. 제가 웬만하면 책 제목 같은 경우 잘 기억을 하는데 리카즈가 쓴 책이 하도 많이 국내에 번역이 돼서 여러분들 글 중에 많이 이런 정도는 한번 들어보셨을 것 같습니다. 금의 기환. 그 다음에 화폐의 몰락. 은행이 멈추는 날. 아우 이거 섬찟합니다. 그 다음에 currency war. 이거 뭐 통화전쟁이라는 말이죠.
네.
currency라는 통화라는 말을 영어로 그대로 책 제목에 썼습니다. 그리고 올해 1월 신대공황
예.
이란 책이 국내에서 이제 출판이 됐습니다.
대공황은 우리가 1929년에 겪었던 그 암흑기를 의미하는데
그렇죠.
신대공황이라면 이제 그런 게 또 한 번 왔다는 뜻입니까?
예.
대개 이제 최근에 벌어지고 있는 경제 환경이 인플레이션 환경이냐 아니면 디플레로 들어가는 과정의 일부분이냐 네. 앞으로 경기는 어떻게 될 것으로 보느냐라는 다소 좀 일반적입니다만 아무도 정답을 알기 어려워서 고민하는 그런 질문을
예.
계속 드려볼 겁니다. 제임스 리카즈와 그러면 인터뷰를 좀 시작을 해볼까요?
네.
네. 바로 그럼.
리카즈 씨. 아, 안녕하세요. 오늘 저희가 한 여섯 가지 질문을 준비했습니다. 준비되셨습니까?
Okay. Well, six questions usually takes me about 6 hours, but I'll give short answers.
리카즈 씨, 올 1월에 한국에서도 최신 저서 신대공황이 출판됐습니다. 축하드립니다. 그런데 신대공황이라 대공황 일단 아주 음울한 느낌이 듭니다. 1929년 대공황이 앞으로 엄습할 수 있다는 얘기인가요?
Thank you. I'm very happy. We have a very good Korean publisher. I think all my books are in Korean. This is the newest one. So it has a good audience. I've been to Korea a number of times. I've been going to Korea for almost 40 years. I love the country. The people are great. It's a very, very beautiful country. I love the food. I'm happy to explain what a depression is and why I call it the new Great Depression. I wouldn't quite say it's doomsday. Doomsday is a bigger subject. But we've had depressions before. We've lived through them. I think we're in one now. It's not the end of the world. But it does mean a change in the world. We'll come out of this, we'll get through this, and we'll be different than we were when we started. So first of all, most, economists and economics writers, they're familiar with the word recession. with the R. So recession has a technical definition. It means two or more consecutive quarters of declining GDP. And economists like it because it's quantitative. You can measure it. You can put it in a formula, et cetera. So people say, well, depression sounds worse than a recession. So if a recession is two quarters of declining GDP, a depression must be 10 quarters of declining GDP. But that's not the definition. You can have growth in a depression, in the Great Depression. I call my book The New Great Depression because I was comparing it to the Great Depression of 1929 to 1940. But in that depression, 11 years, we had two technical recessions. There was a recession from 1929 to 1933, and then there was another recession from 1937 to 1938. From 1933 to 1936, there was pretty good growth, and then growth again after 1938 in sort of preparation for World War II. But the point is, we never got back to the 1929 stock market levels, the 1929 levels of productivity until 1940. In other words, you go down a lot and then you come back up. And in the case of the Great Depression, we went down again and we came back up, but we never got back up here. So you say to people, for example, they know that the US stock market crashed in 1929 and it hit bottom in 1932. So it went down for 3 years, down more than 80%. But then you say, well, when did it get back to the 1929 level? The answer is 1954. It took 25 years to get back to the old level. Now, it doesn't mean that there wasn't growth. The stock market started to go up again in 1932. You could have made money. But the point is, the full cycle to get back to where you were, it took 25 years. And that's what a depression is. It doesn't mean continuous declining growth. You can have some growth, but it means growth below trend. So you have to think of a line. Here's the trend growth or the potential growth, okay? And then here's the actual growth. And there's a gap between the two. And what you have is depressed growth. So you have growth, but it's below trend, it's below potential. And that gap between here's your potential and here's your actual, that gap is a wealth gap. It's money, it's wealth that you could have made, but you did not make because of the effects of the depression, economic policy, et cetera. So my point is, it's not the end of the world. It doesn't mean that things just go straight down, but it means that we come back very slowly. We don't regain the old trend. We leave enormous $1 trillion of wealth on the table. And that life behavior is quite different than it was before. And these effects can last for decades, not months or weeks or years, but decades.
공황이라고 하는 게 서로가 하는 정의가 좀 달라서 다르게 느껴질 수도 있는 것 같은데요. 지금 우리가 공황을 겪고 있다고 하면 그 정도는 아니지 않느냐 하는 생각을 갖고 있는 분들도 그렇죠. 많을 것 같습니다. 네. 리카즈 씨가 생각하는 공황이란 어떤 것인지 조금 다시 한번 좀 설명을 해주시고 지금이 그렇다는 근거, 뭐 증거. 수치 이런 게 좀 있을까요?
I talk about this in my book in chapter 4, I believe. There was an economist from the Federal Reserve Bank of San Francisco and two academic economists, I believe from the University of California, but the paper is in the notes to the New Great Depression. And they looked at every pandemic for the last 650 years in which 100,000 people or 100,000 or more people died. So that was their baseline, 100,000 or more fatalities in the pandemic in the last 650 years. That's my idea of a good time series. A lot of times analysts use a very short time series and say, well, it doesn't mean anything because you haven't looked at things over enough cycles. So they identified 15 pandemics with 100,000 or more fatalities. The two biggest, of course, were the Spanish flu of 1918, 100 million people died, and then the Black Death of the 14th century, 1350s, in which 75 million people died. Number three on the list was the Asian flu of 1958, in which 200,000 people died. So already COVID is number three on the list. We have 2.9 million fatalities. will clearly have more than 3 million. It'll, who knows? It may go to 4 million, et cetera. So we're in the third worst pandemic of the last 650 years. But what but these were economists, not epidemiologists. So they said the reason for doing this, they said, what was the economic effect of these severe pandemics? And what they discovered is that the time to get back to normal, normal defined as, you know, normal interest rate patterns, normal employment patterns, normal output patterns, et cetera, was 30 years. And so I think the world needs to prepare itself for the fact that we're not suddenly going to just bounce back and everything's going to be the same. That's not true. We will have growth. We'll get through this. It's not the end of the world. But the world has changed, adaptive behavior is such that we've changed irrevocably and for decades to come. And that's the big message of the book and the big news that most people don't understand.
근데 최근에 미국의 1분기 성장률 그리고 일본의 1분기 성장률, 유럽의 1분기 성장, 유로존의 1분기 성장률을 보면 상당히 좋습니다. 빠르게 회복하고 있고요. 팬데믹 침체에서 빠르게 벗어나고 있다라는 게 일반적인 이코노미스트들의 얘기입니다. 그런데 신공황, 공황 상태라고 하니 참 석연치 않은데요. 어떤 좀 다시 한번 말씀해 주시겠습니까?
One thing that economists and policymakers are missing. Everyone looks at GDP growth, and that's okay. That's a good measure. So it goes up, and then it goes down, and then it comes back, et cetera. And you have baseline effects, et cetera. But one thing they do not look at, they look at reduced output, but they do not look at lost wealth. In other words, okay, so we're the economy is growing again, at least in the United States, and you know China's doing a little bit better, according to China. But they don't count the lost wealth. What if my restaurant failed? What if I shut my doors, walked away from the lease, terminated my employees, sold my equipment for pennies on the dollar? There, it's not just the declining GDP. The $1 million of wealth has disappeared. It's not a question of destroying $100,000 of output. It's a question of destroying $1 million of wealth. It's gone. And no one measures this. It's difficult to measure. But this is why I make the point that the effects of these things, we're trying to grow, but we've destroyed trillions of dollars of wealth in the process, and no one has measured it.
리카즈 씨, 저 아직도 사실은 경제가 신공황, 신대공황이라는 진단에 대해서 다소 좀 의심이 남아있어서 드리는 질문입니다만 공황이고 어려운 상황이라면 물가는 떨어지는 디플레이션을 우리가 겪고 있어야 될 것 같은데 물가는 오히려 부담스러울 만큼 최근 많이 오르고 있지 않습니까?
So first of all, I would say in the short run, meaning this year, 2021, and into 2022, deflationary or disinflationary pressures will prevail. We're not in an inflationary world. However, we are getting very close to a global inflection point when inflation will take over. But it might not happen until 2023. But when it happens, it may persist for decades. So what I tell investors, and I said this in the New Great Depression in Chapter 6, I said, number one, you need to be diversified. This would be advice to Korean investors or U.S. investors or anyone in the world. First of all, you need to be diversified. Now, that sounds, people laugh and say, well, that's obvious. Of course you want to be diversified. Yes, but they don't understand what diversification is. So you see people, I run into people, they say, well, I'm highly diversified. I have 30 different stocks. I have semiconductors, I have consumer non-durables, I have natural resources, I have 30 different stocks, I'm highly diversified. And I say, no, you're not. You may have 30 stocks, but you have one asset class, which is stocks, and they're highly correlated, and they go up together and down together, and you could lose a lot of money all at once. Real diversification is you have a slice of stocks, slice of cash, slice of gold, slice of real estate. There's room for private equity and venture capital, natural resources. That's real diversification. Because now, if the deflation prevails, you're going to do very well on your cash and treasury notes. If if inflation prevails, you're going to do very well on your gold and natural resources. So you're robust to all these states of the world. Now, you can mix up, you can change the mix. And this is what I call being nimble, you know, because I'll put out a recommended portfolio. And then, and I mean it, and I did a lot of work, and then I'll run into somebody at a conference, it could be in Seoul, you know, a year from now, and I'll talk about inflation, and someone will say, you know, Mr. Rickards, you said deflation, now you say inflation. Well, the answer is, yeah, right now it is deflation, but a year from now or 2 years from now, it could be inflation. So investors need to be alert. I do, you know, I write my books, but I also have newsletters and so forth and other sources. Investors need to be alert. They need to be looking for signals, looking for signs, which I do, you know, that's my main business other than writing. And one of the reasons I recommend cash, I recommend a big allocation to cash, about 30%. And people go, oh, I hate cash because it has no yield. And I say, well, two things. Number one, you're right, it has no yield. But in a deflationary environment, the real value of cash goes up. In a deflation means that you get more for your money. So cash, the value of cash, the real value of cash goes up. So in real terms, cash can be your best performing asset in a deflationary environment, number one. But number two, cash has huge embedded optionality, and people don't understand. They underestimate the optionality. What do I mean by that? If you place your bets, it's like a roulette, going to a roulette game in a casino, you put your bets down, you know, and they spin the wheel. If you say, okay, I'm going to buy this much private equity and these stocks and so forth, if you get it right, that's fine. But if you change your mind, say, you know what, this is not working out so well, I want to get out of it. Well, it can be very expensive to get out. You can't get your money out of a private equity fund. I mean, Henry Kravis is a great manager, but he won't give you your money back early, right? But if you have cash, you can be nimble. You can pivot. You can say, you know what? Inflation's out of control. I want to get some gold. Or, you know, everything, economy's becoming better. I want to buy some stocks. The person with cash can do that. So that optionality is very valuable. I think gold will do well in all states of the world, but I recommend 10% of your investable assets in gold.
다시 확인하는 차원에서 오늘은 계속 제가 재확인만 하고 있네요. 다시 확인하는 차원에서 좀 여쭤보겠습니다. 디플레이션이라고 설명을 해주셔서 다소 뜻밖이었는데 지금은 각국의 중앙은행들, 특히 미국의 중앙은행이 돈을 많이 찍어내고 풀어내고 금리를 낮춰놓는 바람에 인플레이션 우려가 그동안 계속 커져왔고 앞으로도 그렇게 풀어낸 돈이 궁극적으로 강한 인플레를 일으킬 것이다 라는 걱정하는 분들의 이야기도 많이 들리지 않습니까? 그래서 우리는 여전히 디플레가 아니라 이제는 인플레를 걱정해야 되는 단계인 것 같은데 어떤 의견을 갖고 계십니까?
Increasing the money supply does not cause inflation. Milton Friedman said it does. Austrian economists said it does. Neo-Keynesian monetarist economists say it does. It doesn't. We've had massive, massive increases in money supply for the last 13 years. In 2008, the Federal Reserve balance sheet was $800 billion. Today, the Federal Reserve balance sheet is $7.5 trillion. Where's the inflation? so money supply by itself does not cause inflation. What causes inflation is velocity, which is the turnover of money. So an example I give, let's say I go out for dinner and I tip the waitress. I know there's no tipping in Korea, but it's very common in the United States. So I tip the waitress. And the waitress takes a taxi home and she tips the taxi driver. And the taxi driver takes the tip money and puts gasoline in his car. Well, in that example, my dollar had $3 of GDP. There was the waitress tip, the taxi tip, and the gasoline. So that has velocity of three. But let's say instead I stay home and watch television. My money has velocity of zero because I didn't spend it. So I say to people, what is $7 trillion times zero is zero. Meaning if you don't have velocity, you don't have an economy. It's the turnover of money that drives inflation. But right now, the U.S. government is handing out money. Yeah, I got a $1,400 check the other day. I didn't ask for it. I don't need it, but it showed up in my bank account because the government's giving it to 200 million people. But and this is true in the whole country, but people are not spending it. And that's the point. And this shows up in the data. This is not hypothetical. This is in the data. 76% of the government handouts for COVID relief, so-called, is either being saved or it's being used to pay down debt. But paying down debt economically is the same thing as savings. You're deleveraging your balance sheet. In other words, if I pay off debt, if I pay off a credit card, that's not new consumption. It's old consumption. I'm paying off things that where I borrowed the money a year ago, right? But there's no new consumption. Only about 24%. So the government's spending $1 trillion or $2 trillion, but only about 24% of it is going into consumption, which is where velocity would come from. 76% is being saved or used to pay down debt. Pardon me. So behaviorally, we're not getting what the government wants. So if that's all true, and it is because it's in the data, where will the inflation come from? The answer is China, because China has just gone through 30 years of being a giant deflation pump. So what happened in China? Hundreds of millions of people went from the farms to the cities. They got a job doing what I call assembly style manufacturing. So it is manufacturing, but it's like Legos. They're putting parts together, but that's okay. It was a job at very low cost, very low unit labor cost. Well, this was like a giant deflation pump for the whole world. It was just pumping out cheap prices, cheap labor all over the world. And it lowered unit labor costs around the world because if you had to compete with China, you better either give up or have really cheap labor yourself. So it was a deflation pump. But right now, we're at an inflection point where China is going to become inflationary. Why is that? Demographics. We'll look back and see that the one-child policy was the greatest blunder. Leaving aside the morality and the ethics of it, it was the greatest economic blunder in history. Because today, China's population is aging very rapidly. By the way, the same is true in Japan, Russia, Europe, and to some extent, South Korea, and to some extent, the United States. Now, people are not just living a little longer, they're living a lot longer. It's not a question making it to 80 years old. People are living to be 90 and 100. Now, what happens with people like that, when you age, there's a very high correlation to cognitive disabilities, Alzheimer's disease, dementia, Parkinson's disease. So those people themselves are not productive, but they need caregivers. You know, someone's got to take care of them, give them a bath, et cetera. Now, it's a very worthy occupation. It's a very nice thing to do. But it's going to take up an increasingly large part of the labor force is going to be involved as caregivers to very old people who themselves are not productive. The thing about this kind of personal health care, personal caregiving, it does not lend itself to productivity increases. Giving someone a bath hasn't changed in 3,000 years. I mean, you can't automate a bath. Robots don't give baths. It's so you can do it and it's work and you get paid, but it does not lend itself to productivity increases, which is one of the ways that you grow an economy. So what's happening to your productive, your working age population? First of all, it's shrinking. It's getting smaller, but a big part of that is going to caregiving and healthcare. So you have one group that are 90 years old or more suffering cognitive decline. You have another group who are caregivers that does not lend itself to productivity increases. So the group of productive workers is getting smaller and smaller. And so what will they ask? Higher wages. If you're an employer, and you want those people and you've got productivity, you're going to have to pay them more to get them to work. So now China, this is exactly the situation China's in. China's going to switch from being a deflation pump to being an inflation pump. They're going to have to pay higher wages. That means other people around the world will be in a position. They're going to get higher wages also because there's now headroom. And this is going to last for 30 years. So it doesn't happen overnight. It's going to happen gradually, but we'll start to see it in over the next couple of years.
사실 좀 흥미롭죠. 사실 리카즈 씨는 기본적으로 통화 시스템은 늘 그러니까 정부가 종이 쪽지에 그림을 그려서 내놓는 그 통화 커런스는 돈이 아니다, 머니가 아니다, 유일하게 금만이 돈이다라고 주장을 해왔던 골드버그입니다. 그런 사람이 지금 현재 평소의 주장과는 달리 지금 현재는 디플레이션 압력이 커지고 있고 2023년 이후에서나 변곡점을 맞아서 인플레이션 압력이 커질 것이다 라고 얘기를 하고 있습니다.
그러니까 돈을 아무리 많이 풀어도 그 돈이 돌지 않으면 곱하기 0이다.
그렇죠. 그 얘기를 했죠.
그러니까 아무리 많이 풀어놓은 돈이라도 돌지 않으면 소용이 없고 돈이 조금만 풀려 있더라도 그 돈이 쌩쌩 돌면 그거는 이제 인플레다 이 말이잖아요.
그렇죠. 인플레이션으로 이어질 수 있다.
그러니 항상 우리는 그 속도를 봐야지 풀려 있는 돈의 양을 가지고 놀라거나 실망하지 마라.
예.
그 얘기 같아요.
대표적으로 사실 이쯤에서 한번 말씀을 추가적으로 드려야 될 게 하나 있는데요. 사실 그 아주 고전적인 경제 이론이죠. 화폐 수량설. 통화량, 통화 돈의 공급이 늘면 물가가 올라간다. 사실 그 대전제는 화폐의 회전 속도, 유통 속도라고 하는 그 속도가 일정하다라고 하는 전제가 있었을 때 성립하는 거거든요.
사람들이 주머니에 돈이 들어오기만 하면 기꺼이 쓰려고 한다. 항상 그 정도는 일정하다.
심지어는 중앙은행이 통화 공급을 하고 시중은행이 대출을 해줬을 때에 그 돈이 세상에 돈 싫어하는 사람 없으니까 완벽한 돈의 수요를 가정합니다.
네.
공급하는 만큼 수요가 발생할 것이다.
돈이 없어서 못 쓰지 뭐 돈 쓸 데가 없겠냐.
아 그렇죠.
그건 항상 만고불변의 법칙이다 그 말이죠.
예, 아주 소박한 가설이죠. 네. 사실 근데 우리가 이미 경험하고 있듯이 일본에서 경험했듯이 그 엄청난 법정 통화를 법정 화폐를 쏟아붓고 찍어내고 심지어는 뿌리기까지 했는데도 money demand 통화 수요 돈의 수요는
안 쓰죠.
그렇게 늘지 않았죠.
저도 오늘 점심에 모듬 김밥을 먹을까 그냥 야채 김밥을 먹을까 하다가 그냥 야채 김밥을 먹었지 않습니까?
이게 경제의 범죄입니다. 고소득자는 반드시 써야 하는 거죠.
나 이렇게 뭐가 더 들었다고 4천 원이야 이렇게 생각하고 저는 그냥 야채 김밥 먹었죠. 바로 이게 물론 먹으려면 먹을 돈이 없기야 했겠습니까? 그러나 돈이 풀려 있다고 해서 다 그렇게 돌고 쓰고 하는 건 아니다. 그 얘기를 이 프로가 하면 김밥 얘기가 되고 리카지 이분이 하면 뭔가 경제적인 학설이 되네.
학설이 되는 거고.
가치 투자는 재무 제품만 보면 된다는 생각에 기술적 분석은 쳐다도 안 봤는데 꼭 필요하다는 것을 느꼈습니다. 아무것도 몰랐지만 이해 가능할 수 있게 잘 가르쳐 주셔서 감사합니다.
아, 막상 자료를 찾아봐도 어떻게 시작해야 할지 몰랐는데 함께 사이트를 둘러보면서 하나씩 설명해 주니까 너무너무 재밌었어요.
와, 1년 동안 감으로 매매한 저를 반성합니다. 1강만 봐도 대박, 완전 추천합니다.
주식 투자에 대해서 모르는 게 많아서 허전했었는데 빈 곳을 채워주는 무엇 하나 버릴 것 없는 좋은 기초 교육 강의인 것 같습니다.
제가 그동안 너무 무모하게 주식 투자를 하고 있다는 걸 깨달았습니다. 좋은 투자 방향의 이정표가 되어준 강의라고 생각합니다.
염블리의 친절한 주식 기초교육, 실제 수강생들의 따끈한 강의 후기를 들어봤습니다. 이베스트 투자증권 염승환 부장이 하나하나 짚어가며 알려주는 주식 기초교육 시청 방법 및 자세한 사항은 페이지 2 공지사항을 확인하세요.
거시적인 질문보다는 좀 구체적인 질문을 좀
뭘 사면 돈 되는지 좀 여쭤보죠.
아, 그렇죠.
예.
아, 참. 리카 씨 설명의 끝부분에 10% 정도를 금으로 채워라 라고 말씀하셨는데 제가 리카즈 씨를 오해하고 있나요? 사실 그 리카즈 씨는 금만이 돈이다. 이른바 골드버그 가운데 한 명으로 알려져 있습니다. 어떻습니까? 그래서 좀 깜짝 놀랐습니다. 사실은 단 10%만을 포트폴리오 10% 정도만을 금으로 채워라라고 해서 100%도 아니고 50%도 아니고 10%를 금으로 채우라고 해서 선뜻 이해하지 못하겠습니다. 좀 더 자세한 설명을 좀 부탁드리겠습니다.
People always want to put words in your mouth and they say, "But Jim Rickards says sell everything and buy gold." I've never said that. I don't believe that. I think a 10% allocation is fine. 10% you're going to make so much money. It's going to kind of ensure protect the rest of your portfolio. But if I'm wrong, you won't be hurt badly. A 10% allocation, if it goes down 20%, that's 2% of your portfolio. So you're not hurt badly. But if I'm right, you're going to make a lot of money. It's going to protect other things that may lose value. So number one, diversification, but real diversification. Number two, be nimble, pay attention because things do change. And number three, cash has a role for now, maybe not forever, but that cash is your, that gives you your flexibility. And then when we have more visibility, when we can see better, you can be the person who can pivot and make money that way. So that's how I think about it. A lot of it depends on predictive analytics, your ability to see what's coming, in other words. But that's really my specialty. I started a company that is working on that. We have technology. We're getting a U.S. patent, et cetera. I make the point that it's not a crystal ball. So I don't look into a crystal ball and see the future. The future is here today. The future is in the present. But you have to understand the present. And most people don't. They're looking in a rearview mirror. They understand what happened, but they don't understand where we are today. And if you can ascertain that, then you can see what's coming next.
1971년 닉슨이 금태환을 중단한 이후에부터는 돈 이퀄 은행권, 그것도 중앙은행권 이게 이제 되지 않습니까?
같은 얘기였다.
예. 그 이전에는 사실은 예. 엄밀하게 커런시와 머니는 구분했었습니다.
커런시는 머니를 기반으로 발행해서 쓰는 그냥 편리하게 도와주는
그렇죠. 유통수단이라는 거죠.
옛날로 치면 우리 저 학생들 버스 탈 때 쓰는 회수권.
예, 일종의 그래서
토큰, 식권 예, 이런
토큰,
게
영어로 토큰이라는 말이 법적인 의미에서 그 어떤 교환의 매개 수단으로 발행된 것들을 일반적으로 토큰이라고 부릅니다.
그게 커런시와 머니 중에 뭐예요? 그게 회수권 토큰 이런
그게
게.
그게 이제 법적인 강제 통용권을 지니게 되면 커런시에 가까 되는 거죠.
커런시. 예. 그리고 그 커런시의 가치를 보존해 주는 뭔가는 골드 같은 거는 그게 머니.
그렇죠. 그러다 지금 현재는 커런시를 뒷받침할 수 있는 게 없으니까
바뀌었죠. 뭐 그냥
그러다 보니까 이 골드버그, 찍어내니까. 이 리카즈 이런 사람들은 이런 분들은 기본적으로 머릿속에 과거에 커런시와 머니가 구분됐다라고 하는 그 시절을 바탕으로 논리를 네. 전개하는 사람들이거든요.
그러니까 커런시는 의미 없으니 머니를 자꾸 주머니에 넣어놔라.
아, 그렇죠. 그 여기서 말하는 머니는 뭐냐? 금이죠.
뭐 골드 그런 얘기인데 예. 그런 골드를 보관하는 전략이 궁극적으로 승리하려면 네. 골드의 가치는 올라가고 이 커런시의 가치는 떨어져야 되는 거 아니겠습니까?
그렇죠. 근데 디플레이션이
그렇지 그러니까 이게 이제 그런 상황이라면 인플레이션이고 그렇게 금을 보유하라고 주장하는 분이라면 인플레이션 상황을 가정하는 분일 텐데
예.
오늘은 계속 요즘은 디플레이션이고 앞으로도 꽤
심지어는 대공황이라고 하고. 신공황이라고 이런 말도 하지 않습니까?
그러니 그러면 지금 금을 버릴까요? 아니면 금을 계속 갖고 있을까요? 이 질문 좀 드려봐야 될 것 같은데 형이 좀 물어보세요.
아니 근데 지금 아까 말했듯이 포트폴리오 가운데 네. 10% 정도는 꼭 금을 가지고 있어라. 그리고 인플레이션이든 디플레이션이든 그것을 아까 말했듯이 이 리카즈 씨는 디플레이션에 네. 시대의 분산 투자, 분산의 요건들 자세히 아까 설명했습니다. 그 점에 대해서 평소에 정확하게 말 지난해까지 저하고 인터뷰를 했을 때 해왔던 말과는 달라서 계속 재확인 차원에서 이걸 예. 다시 여쭙니다라는 우리 인터뷰를
알겠어요.
했지 않습니까?
예. 그럼에도 불구하고 한 번만 더 여쭤보겠습니다.
재확인 차원에서 드리는 질문이 오늘 꽤 많습니다. 사실 그 평소 리카즈 씨 본인은 싫어할 수도 있습니다만은 금만이 돈이다라고 주장하는 골드버그 가운데 대표적인 인물로 리카즈 씨가 꼽히고 있습니다. 어떤가요? 지금 오늘 말씀하시는 걸로 봐서는 골드버그인가? 이분이 골드버그인가? 라는 의문이 듭니다. 어떻습니까? 본인 스스로 생각하기에 이 골드버그라는 말을 어떻게 생각하시는지요?
I don't consider myself a gold bug. I'm an analyst. I write about gold. I talk about gold. I do recommend it to investors. I have some myself. But to me, it's the result of analysis. And you know, gold has in dollar terms, the dollar price of gold has gone down in the last 3 months. So everyone goes, oh, well, gold's going down. No, I mean, yeah, it has gone down for the last 3 months, but the bottom in the gold market in the last bear market was December 16, 2015. It was $1,050 an ounce. So that's a 70% increase in 5 years. Okay, I know it was $2,070 an ounce on August 8th, 2020. I understand that. And you can say it's down 10% more like 15% from there, which is true. But it's up 70% in the last 6 years. If you go back to 1999, gold was $250 an ounce. So that's up almost 1,000%, about 10 times, not quite. So the point being, say 8 times, so 800% since 1999. So, and if you go back to 1971, it was $35 an ounce. So it's up over 5,000%. So the trend of gold is up, the long-term trend is up. And I do expect it to hit $10,000 an ounce in the coming years, partly because of the inflation we just talked about. But as if gold goes up in $1,000 increments, each increment is a smaller percentage of the prior base. So for example, let's just say gold is $2,000 an ounce. It's a little bit below that now, but just use it as a round number. For gold to go from $2,000 an ounce to $3,000 an ounce, that's a 50% increase. But to go from $14,000 an ounce to $15,000 an ounce, that's only a 7% increase. But each $1,000 increment gets easier than the one before because it's a smaller and smaller percentage. Going from 10 to 11 is a 10% increase. Going from 14 to 15 is a 7% increase. Going from 20 to 21 is only a 5% increase. In other words, and this is why these curves go like this, and all of a sudden they go like this. They go parabolic. For people to say, "Well, gee, it's below $2,000 an ounce. $10,000 an ounce seems like it's like climbing Mount Everest. It just seems really, really high." And my answer is, it gets easier at the end. The real Mount Everest gets more difficult, but the price of gold will get easier because it's always a smaller percentage of wherever you started. So yeah, it's going to take a while for gold to get from 2,000 to 3,000. Then 3,000 to 4,000, that's a 33% increase. But then it can happen very rapidly after that. So all the more reason to get gold today, because you'll participate in all those gains. Because when gold is $8,000 an ounce, all of your friends will be calling you. They'll all be out buying gold. Where can I get gold? How do I get gold? You'll say, there'll be a frenzy. Well, that's okay. But get in today, protect your net worth. Gold is a very good hedge, and then you'll participate in that frenzy when it comes, which it will.
마지막으로 제가 하나만 좀 여쭤보겠습니다. 요즘은 새로운 금이 등장했어요.
네. 예,
바로 새로운 금이라고 주장하는 암호화폐들이 있는데 어떻습니까? 그러면 달러화는 예상외로 떨어지지는 않고 있고 가치가 그렇게 되면 암호화폐 혹은 가상자산이라고 불리는 새로운 이 자산들의 앞날에 대해서는 개인적으로 어떻게 생각하시는지 좀 여쭙고 싶습니다.
Well, they actually, those things are connected. So when people say the dollar goes up or down, what do they mean? How do they measure it? Well, you have a DXY, which is a futures contract. There's a Bloomberg dollar index. The Federal Reserve has a broad trade-weighted dollar index. So there are a number of indices that you can look at to see if the dollar is going up or down. Well, when you say, well, what's in the index? It's always the euro US dollar cross rate. I mean, that's the lion's share of it. There are other currencies, Swiss franc, you know, Korean won, Japanese yen, but it's mostly the euro US dollar cross rate. So you're comparing currency to currency and telling me what a currency is worth. Well, how do you do that? They're both currencies. In other words, if the euro gets weaker, okay, the dollar gets stronger and the index goes up, but they're all passengers in the same lifeboat. They're all going to survive or sink together. So there's no world where the dollar collapses and everyone says, get me some euros or get me some yen. That world doesn't exist. All these currencies are either going to, they trade in ranges, you know, that's normal, but they're all going to sink together or prosper together. So if I talk about a dollar collapse, which I do, this applies to all the major reserve currencies, not just the dollar. What is the measuring stick? How can I actually tell? Well, my answer is gold. So that look at the dollar price of gold, because that's two forms of money. You're comparing two forms of money, gold and the dollar, but gold is not a central bank currency. So if I see the dollar price of gold going up, that means the dollar is getting weaker, measured by weight of gold. If you're a currency trader, it's fine, but don't look at DXY, don't look at the Bloomberg Index, don't look at the Fed Index, don't look at any of those things, because that's just currency to currency. Look at the dollar price of gold. That's the thermometer you use to tell if the patient is sick. Now, with regard to Bitcoin, I have a long explanation about Bitcoin, but here's the point. If you think that Bitcoin is a form of money, the dollar has already lost 95% of its value. If Bitcoin was $3,000 and today it's $60,000, that's about where it is. Okay, so what does that mean? If Bitcoin is your form of money, it means the dollar has lost 90% of its value. Well, is that what happened? This is the question. If Bitcoin is not a form of money, if it's just a form of gambling, then fine. But people who own Bitcoin yell, no, it's the new reserve currency. It's going to displace the dollar. It's, you know, okay, instead of having that debate, let's just say hypothetically that's true. Okay, I don't necessarily agree, but let's say it's true. Well, that means the dollar has already collapsed. So which is it? If Bitcoin is money, the dollar has already lost 90% of its value in the last couple of years. If Bitcoin is not money, then it's like playing roulette. But you have to choose. I'll leave it at that. I won't try to answer the question, but I'll pose the question.
달러 가치가 상대적으로 표현한다면은 그 블록체인의 가치로 표현한다라면은 90% 이상 추락했다는 건데 일리카즈는 우리 달러 가치 지금 이제 90% 추락했으면은 이 뭐랄까 그러니까 머니 크라이시스가 발생해야 되는 거거든요. 그러니까 통화 가치 위기. 그렇지 않죠.
은근히 비트코인을 빚고 와서 네. 돌렸어.
그렇죠. 그렇지 않다. 그러니까 그렇다라면은 비트코인은 그 어떤 도박의 수단이라고 봐야 되지 않느냐.
비트코인이 자꾸 가치가 오르는 것에 대해서 비트코인에 대한 신봉론자들은 돈 가치가 떨어졌으니까 비트코인이 오르죠 라고 주장을 하나.
그렇죠.
당신들은 말이 맞다면 돈 가치가 그럼 올해 90%나 떨어졌다는 뜻이냐.
그렇죠. 일시적이지만 90%냐 떨어졌다는 가치가 얘기인데.
떨어지기는 합니다만 그렇게 떨어지지는 않는다. 그러니 비트코인이 그렇게 많이 오르는 게 말이 안 되지 않느냐라는 이야기를.
그렇죠.
돌려서 했던 것 같아요. 예.
리카즈 씨, 아까 얼핏 그 초반부에 한국에 자주 와봤다라고 하셨는데 정말 팬데믹이 사라져서 다시 한국에 오셔가지고 얼굴을 마주하고 인터뷰를 한번 하고 싶습니다.
네.
감사합니다.
Thank you very much. You too. I look forward to coming back to Korea someday when we can.
사실 저도 사실 시간만 더 있다라면은 아니면 얼굴을 마주보고 있다라면은 좀 더 공격적으로 과거에 이렇게 언제 어느 순간에 이렇게 말씀하셨는데 왜 지금은 말이 달라지느냐
우리말은
왜 말을 바꿨느냐
야 이 친구야 당신 지난 몇 년간 금사라고 했는데
네.
뭐 그런 이야기
심지어는 지난해 제하고 통화했을 때에
네.
금값이 온스당 만 달러 넘어가는 일도 아니다라고 말했거든요. 그런데 지금 금값이 뭐 만 달러 수준은 아니지 않습니까?
2천 달러가 채 안 되죠.
그쵸.
온스당. 예. 네.
물론 그 일부 투자 은행가들이 지난해 한참 패닉이 절정에 달했을 때, 패닉이 심할 때는 뭐 온스당 8천 달러
예.
지난해 연말까지 올라갈 수 있다라는 전망을 내기도 했습니다. 그러나 우리 그 3프로 구독자님들께서 보시기에 아직 그 예측은 보기 좋게 어긋난 걸로 봐야 되겠죠.
예. 그래서 이렇게 금 좋아하시던 분이 디플레라고 하시니까 우리는 오늘 이런저런 다양한 질문들을 좀 드려서 어떤 생각인지 구체적으로 알아봤더니
네. 나름대로 자기 생각과 개념에 대한 정의는 분명히 하고
네.
그 말을 한 걸로 보입니다.
그러네요.
예.
우리는 경기가 반등하고는 있으나 네. 전반적으로는 아직 전후 복구가 안 끝난 상태다.
예.
그 얘기였어요.
예.
그리고 그 후유증이 여기저기서 앞으로도 계속될 수 있다는 주제의 이야기 제임스 리카즈와 함께했습니다. 예, 글로벌 모니터는 또 다음 시간에 또 더 좋은 인사이트를 갖고 있는 다른 분들을 찾아서 또 인터뷰를 해보겠습니다. 시청해주신 여러분 고맙습니다.
감사합니다.
예, 안녕하십니까. 여러분 박병창입니다. 매매 기술이라는 책 제목으로 나왔는데요. 작년에 2020년도에 코로나 바이러스로 인해서 시장이 폭락을 했지 않습니까? 그동안에 주식을 계속 들고 있었으면은 수익이 났겠죠. 그때 당시에 그러면 매수 신호가 있었냐 없었냐? 매수 신호가 있었습니다. 그 매수 신호가 뭐냐를 가르쳐 드리려고 하는 거예요. 그래서 이런 것들을 제가 방송을 하면서 세세히 설명을 못 드리잖아요. 굉장히 추상적인 얘기고 그때 보여드렸던 건 거의 대부분 제가 생각하기에는 타이틀만 보여드린 거고요. 실제로 그 왜 그렇게 되는가에 대해서 설명을 세세하게 써놨다고 보시면 되지 않을까 생각합니다.